This episode is brought to you by Shushi Sunglasses, Abuja's favorite sunglasses brand. We don't hide behind our shades. We own it. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Rodio Mokache and welcome to the Young God Podcast, a podcast for gods. This is a show where I curate ideas, conversations, and stories that help us better visualize what we might look like as the best version of ourselves. Today's guest is Nadine Ibrahim. Some of you may know her as a photographer and filmmaker, while some of you may know her as the daughter of Mrs. Amina J. Mohammed, the Deputy Secretary General of the United Nations. Fun fact, Nadine actually dislikes being mentioned next to or compared to her mother, so I can just imagine her face as she's listening to this intro. I'm sorry, Nadine. I had to name drop your mama. I'm sorry. But Nadine also hates coffee. She loves sugar and hates being in the kitchen. She's a creative individual in every sense of the word and just the kind of person I love to have on the show. She opened up to me about the harrowing experience of 3 miscarriages back to back to back and then finding meaning in her suffering. We also talked about how filmmaking helped take her mind off the losses and how those losses themselves allowed her to dedicate herself to her latest project, which is called Scarred. And it's a documentary about the culture of facial scarification in Nigeria. My conversation with Nadine started out a bit slow as we were both getting comfortable, you know, getting to know each other. But like a roller coaster, it built up to a stunning exchange of stories, wisdom, and truth. I'm very happy to put this out and I hope you enjoy. Coming up next, Nadine Ibrahim. Ladies and gents, you good? Ladies and gents, I'm here at TF1 Cafe with a very, very special guest. It's been a long time coming. She almost forgot about this in typical busy woman fashion. Nadine Ibrahim, please, you're welcome, Nadine.
Thanks for having me. I honestly don't know what I just got myself into, but cool.
You don't even know. We don't know. Let's see. Hey, I mean, I've been following you for a bit. Mm-hmm. I mean, Nadine Ibrahim is ubiquitous in this parts. If you know what I mean? No.
No.
Like a person that, you know, people fuck with, you know? Mm. That's basically what it is. So, but I didn't know I wanted to have you on the podcast until I saw you at the thing. In fact, I was with Aisha Sambo.
Okay.
And she was like, Rodney, you should have her.
Oh, yeah?
On the podcast. And I was like, why didn't I even think of that? You get. And then that's when I came up. Remember when I came up to you and I introduced myself?
Yeah. I remember that. Mm-hmm. I was thinking, who is this guy?
Yeah. Do you think I was going to check you?
No.
Okay.
I actually thought you were coming for my mom because everybody was coming for my mom at that event.
Oh. And you know what? Like, okay. You know what? I haven't really experienced your mom until I came for that.
Really?
Yeah. So, but I was impressed. Mm-hmm. You know, I heard her speak for the first time at that, that thing. And she said some things that really resonated with me, especially around the, you know, when we're talking about how Nigerians kind of like feel like their reputation because of the bad things that other Nigerians do, mm-hmm. that kind of somehow rubs on us. Mm-hmm. And she kind of like, nah, you know, the way she like explained it. And I was like, yeah, she gets it. She gets it.
She has that effect on people.
Mm-hmm. And like, we can see the apple doesn't fall too far from the tree.
Nah.
Yeah.
I don't like it when people say that because it's pressure. Because she's like this huge ass entity, and I'm like,
what's life without pressure, though? Yeah.
Calm.
who come
no expectations, but now there's so many expectations being her daughter.
And don't you think you'd be, cool. you'd be better for it in the long run?
Yeah, I guess so.
You know, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I mean, think of people who don't have that kind of background,
mm-hmm.
so they have to like find ways to pressure themselves.
You know? I guess so.
You yeah, have it.
The pressure is good.
You have it free. Free of charge. Okay. Her coffee's here.
Hot chocolate.
Oh, chocolate.
Definitely a hot chocolate person, not coffee.
Really?
Yeah. I actually hate coffee.
Ooh.
Can I have more sugar, please?
That's a sweet lady right
Thank
there.
Thank you. Yeah.
So
I
just
always have to add sugar to my hot chocolate. It's bad, but yeah.
Do what you gotta do. Get your fix anyhow you can get it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So let me describe the scene real quick. So Nadine is sitting across from me on the couch. Her hair is up. She's very comfortable.
Yep.
In a black tee and a blue jeans. Feet up. And she's just trying to like read the situation, like what's about to go down. And we don't know, but she's here and she has a nice watch on. I think that's is that bronze or rose gold?
Rose gold.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Rose gold. Mm.
Simple.
And straight.
Not about that extra life.
Not at the moment, at least.
No, I don't think ever.
If you don't know Nadine, Nadine is a photographer, filmmaker, an all-round creative individual.
Mm-hmm.
And she's also not bad to look at.
Why, thank you.
You're very welcome. You know, I think of you like a Renaissance woman.
Why?
Why? We're in an age where it's easier than ever to like learn a skill.
Mm-hmm.
And a Renaissance man or Renaissance person,
mm-hmm.
and if you think back to the Renaissance ages,
mm-hmm.
when we had the Da Vinci's and all them guys and Michelangelo's,
mm-hmm.
the deal was being able to master as many skills as possible,
mm-hmm.
and use that to like enrich your world and like just express yourself as much as you can. So when I see you do what you do, I can think of you in that light, you know, as someone who has, you know, quite a bit of skills under her belt and is able to like deploy them when necessary. Is that accurate?
Yeah. Well, to be honest, being a filmmaker, you have to have all the skills because you have to, there's like so many different elements that you can't fall short on any, because if you do, then you end up messing up.
Yeah. You get like I've mm-hmm. mastered skills along the way that have like got me to this point,
mm-hmm.
and helped me, you know, add value to myself and to people I work with.
Mm-hmm.
And I should have put that on silence.
You should have
a long time ago.
First rule before you hit action,
you
and
know.
Hit the record button.
Rookie mistake,
man.
Hey, yeah. Let me just.
Where's my phone? Actually,
okay. Over there.
Cool.
So, what else can you do?
What else can I do?
I know you fly the drone. I know you can take pictures. I know you can
direct, edit.
Yeah.
Right.
Uh huh.
What else? I don't know.
Surprise us, please.
I would say cook, but I don't know how to cook. I actually hate being in the kitchen.
Okay.
What can I do? That's about it. I used to love painting, but I haven't done it in a while. It was like one of those therapeutic things that I used to do when I was younger, but
mm-hmm.
not so much now. No time.
What therapeutic things do you do now?
Watch movies, that's all.
Mm. Wow, that is so odd.
If I'm not making movies, I'm watching movies.
Yeah, it's like, don't you like take a break from like movies? Having to make one and then watch them too, like...
Yeah, sometimes it gets much. To be honest, I actually don't know what I do in my free time. I very rarely have free time these days, which is very crazy. When I do, I'm just chilling with my family, to be honest.
Mm.
Yeah.
With hubby?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And my niece. I'm in love with my niece. I take her everywhere.
Oh, I get that. I became a godfather this year.
Okay, cool. Congrats.
Yeah. Yeah, so I know what that is like. Like, he's like my responsibility almost. Not even almost, like basically.
Is.
You know, and I show him off every opportunity. Like, I'm a godfather now. Put some respect in my name, you know?
A new status.
Do you get? You know, so... but yeah, I'm really enamored with people who are like good at a lot of things. I think right now we live in a world where the future belongs to those who can, you know, master and combine skills, multiple skills in different ways, different creative ways. So it's not just enough to specialize anymore. Yep. Like, gone are those days.
You have to do more than one thing.
More than one thing.
Yeah, but that's tricky though, because a lot of people now try to do more than one thing and then they end up slipping because they're not perfect at any other thing. Like, if you end up focusing on doing too many things, you're going to end up not being great at least one. That's what I think anyway.
Well, yeah, well, I guess, well, yeah, true that. But I think the trick now is like not to like learn them all at the same time. You start one place, you get to a certain level of proficiency.
And then you pick up a new skill.
Yeah. And then over time, it becomes, you know, part of your DNA.
Yeah.
And then now, because when I think about it, like I started as a photographer, no, as a musician, then a photographer. And then I did some writing. Like, yeah. If I'm writing a book, then I did, now I'm into brand strategy. I build brands.
Okay.
And then I have a podcast. And then... everything that I've done has got me to this point where usually starting a podcast and like, you know, getting this kind of traction would take a lot more time. From my experience doing all kinds of things, now it's like doing better than expected in a short period of time. So yeah, it's, and it just makes my life just more interesting, just being able to do a lot of stuff, like, and not having to depend on people.
Yeah,
you get actually the main thing. Like, no one can hold you to ransom. You get, like, if you, and then what that makes you do now is that you kind of like simplify your life, because you can do a lot of things and maybe you have to do them to get things done. You kind of like cut out the things that you don't need to have, so you can like focus and
you don't have to depend on people so much. But then that's the thing, you have to get to the point where you know how to control and manage all of it. Because now if I ask you, who are you? Like, before anything else, who are you? What is your answer?
I'm a god.
No, you can't say that.
Why not?
Like, what is the one thing that you're good at and no one can knock you for? Because I was having this conversation with my editor a few days ago. And I asked him, like... if someone is to ask, like, what are you good at? Like, what are you known for? And he said he's a director, he's an editor, he's a photographer, he's this, he's that. And I'm like, no, okay, so, well, what do you want to be known for? You can be good at all of these things. Yes, you have the skill, but what are you? Who are you? And then he says he's a director. And I'm like, okay, so you're getting somewhere. You know exactly what you want to be. You might have all the skills in the world, but before anything, like, who are you?
That is interesting. And that is one way to look at it. But for me, the way I see it is like, I am different things to different people.
Okay.
Some people knew me as a photographer. Some people know me as a brand strategist, brand developer. Some people know me as just from podcasting. And what I would always say is I'm a creative individual. First and foremost. And all those different skills are just ways of expressing that. I don't want to hold myself to ransom to like having to commit to one thing. So all in all, I'm a creative individual. Like, that's what I do. Like, everything about me, like even just the way I see the world is just not ordinary. You're selling yourself short, I think, if you like
put yourself in that box. I think saying you're creative works. Or saying you're a filmmaker works, because it houses all of that under like one thing. That's cool. But then if you're to then go into, okay, you're a filmmaker, but what aspect of film? You can't just say, oh, I'm everything. Because like I could say, oh, I'm everything because I know how to do every single thing. But the one thing that I'm sure that you can't knock me for is directing. So I'd be like, okay, yeah, I do everything else, but like directing is my forte. Like that's that you can't knock me for. So that's, it's that kind of thing where you have, I guess, I don't know. It goes back to the whole, like, what's that saying?
Jack of all trades.
Yes, exactly. Master of none. Yeah.
But you know, the full thing, you know, the history has a way of like adjusting things to fit their narrative. But the actual saying, the original saying is Jack of all trades, master of none, but still better than master of one. Yeah.
Is that the whole full saying? That's the full saying.
That's the full saying.
Really? I didn't know that.
So it's actually, it's like, it's in your best interest to, you know, like when you're able to do many things, it actually just widens your mind. You know, it like, because the mind likes to be stretched. And when you're able to like take one field and take another field and do something amazing with both of them or three of them, that's really where like creativity is at its best.
I guess you can tap into all your skills to like be perfect. But yeah, I don't know.
So now you could be the best at that combination of skills. You get.
But then how do you define yourself there? Or you don't have to define yourself. Who says you have to define yourself?
And you could, but you could define yourself. You get to decide. It's your story. It's your life.
Okay.
You know, that's what I can look you in the eye and say, I am a god. And you look at me and be like, how dare you? And like, it's my narrative. It's what I've chosen to define myself based on my experiences, what I've been through, what I've overcome. And I think actually by the time we get to the crux of this conversation, I think you might see yourself a little bit differently as well.
Oh yeah. So when you say you're a god, is it like on a religious standpoint, spiritual standpoint, or just on a, I don't know, on a basis of you see yourself being someone that can do everything and anything?
No. Well, it's a combination of all kinds of things. Okay, first of all, spiritually, I feel like since we're made in the image of God, and we can't tell what God looks like physically. We don't know if he has two eyes, a nose, a mouth, whatever. But we do know that we're made in his image. So the closest thing I can think of is that ability to create. That's the one thing that we have and share with God. Like, that's his essence in us. The ability to, you know, put out into the world what we want to see. The same way he created the world, you know, 7 days, and then he now took out, on the seventh day, he had like self-care. You know, to rest. So it's kind of the same thing with us, where, you know, we have, each of us has the ability, if you wanted to, if you wanted to tap into it, to apply that creative energy to every aspect of our lives and, you know, bring forth something that is good. Now, the other aspect, the other aspect is someone who's working on excellence, someone who is committed to being better every day. Someone who has, you know, made the conscientious decision to approach every situation with, you know, with love, you know, with like not responding with the same energy people give you, just trying to be the best version of yourself. And that's the only thing, like, when I say God, I mean God unto myself. Not, it's not like a title, it's like, it's a state of mind. I feel like I'm my element. Like, I feel like when I'm doing me, it is to the glory of God himself. And somewhere in the Bible, it says, know that ye are gods, but also my children. So, like, God is speaking to us. But, like, the little g, not like the big G. So, I feel like anyone who embodies that is, you know, a god in their own right. So, you could be, whether you're, like, the master of a skill, like Serena, we can call her god of tennis. In that, she's a goddess. She has taken on that challenge and trained and strived. You know, when you're challenged, when things happen to you and you overcome them, you know, that's a god mentality. Because the average person would likely let their shortcomings hold them back, or let their problems, struggles define them. But when you're able to overcome them and be better for it, that takes superhuman resilience, patience, humility, whatever you want to call it, all those soft skills that are in such high demand but low supply in this world. And we need more people like that who are gonna like go into spaces and
break just boundaries.
Yeah, yeah. So Nadine, believe it or not, you're a god, you know, for various reasons, for, you know, being a master of skills, you know, being yourself, you know, overcoming your challenges, you know, just and inspiring people. That's really what it is. And you gotta own it.
Well, thank you for the compliment.
You're welcome. Hey everyone, have you heard of Shushi sunglasses? No? They're a young, fresh and fun eyewear brand based right here in Abuja. Their shades come in a variety of shades, shapes and sizes. But my favorite thing about them is probably the names. There's a pair called the Alter and another called the Black Mamba, which is my favorite. You gotta see it to believe it. You know the hype is real when people like DJ Copy, World and Deja start wearing them. We all need a good pair of shades with which to shine on these haters, so why not check out Shushi Shades on IG for more information on where to buy and what they cost. That's S-H-U-S-H-I Shades, one word. Tell them Rodney sent you the discount. So, Halloween. I know you were thinking of what to do this Halloween. I saw one of your stories and I was like,
yeah.
What's your fascination with that?
Well, I've always been, when I was younger, I used to love horror movies. Like, it was our thing with our family. Every Friday, we'd all sit down and watch a horror movie and, like, scare the crap out of ourselves.
Yeah.
But that stopped along the way at some point. And then we stopped, like, I guess, taking note of it. Maybe we just grew up. But I don't know. This year, it feels like I want to do something.
Yeah? There's quite a bit of...
I like horror houses and haunted houses and all that stuff. So, like, but we don't have that stuff here, do we?
Like, we don't have a space, but I think
there are a couple of people do stuff?
That are doing things.
Not like clubbing. Like, I'm not a clubbing person. So, like, a lot of time people are like, oh, we're going to go out, dress up. I don't like that kind of stuff. I prefer, like, an experience where, like, you literally go through, like, a doom house and get scared and, like, go to a place where it's, like, chilled. Like, it could be a party and maybe, like, bloody drinks kind of thing. But, like, not, like, loud music and you can't hear yourself and you're just tired at the end.
Yeah, and that's really what it is. Like, I feel you, like, I don't like to go to club. Like, that's not my thing. Mm-hmm. It's not my first idea of a good time. Mm-hmm. I mean, I could go there, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's alcohol, there's shisha, and then there's beautiful people. But, you know, that's not my first thing. Mm-hmm. I love to play. I love bouncing castles. There's a place I used to go to. Just here in Wisita, I just go there and I go in the trampoline and I jump for hours.
Yeah, that's the kind of stuff
I like. And I swim in their ball pit. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's my shit. Video games.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's the kind of stuff I'm looking forward to.
Yeah.
I wish I could create something like that, like a permanent thing here, where it's just like a adult wonderland, and you just go and just experience just like being a kid again.
I put on my story one time, like, so we need to organize a party like that.
Mm-hmm.
Like, get all these things that are supposed to be for kids and let, like, adults, like, actually have...
Adult-sized ball pits, that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm.
That would make so much sense.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously, there'll be alcohol and stuff, you know, so you can even get more into zone, but yeah, still... Mm-hmm. Do you drink, by the way?
Mm-mm.
Of course not. What am I saying? Do you smoke?
No.
What's your vice?
Nothing. I hate that question because I never know what to answer. I'm actually just a good girl, I swear. Yep. I don't do any. It's actually, I actually sometimes feel left out because every time someone says, what's your vice? I'm like, I don't have one. Like, do you have to have one? I don't have one.
I mean, you don't have to have one, but vices are nice. Vices remind you that, like, there are things that make doing the things you hate worth it.
Yeah, I guess so. But, like, I guess I haven't found my vice.
I think you have. You just don't want to share. Or I think you have, but you don't know it's a vice. You're still in that denial phase, like, you know, I'm a good girl, so this can't be that bad.
No.
But...
I just ain't got no vice.
Hey. So, Nala Foundations. The founder.
Who's that?
Isn't that you?
Me?
You're not?
I'm joking. Of course it's me.
What's that about?
Nyla Foundation.
Yeah.
So Nyla Foundation came about in January. Yeah, 30th of January, I think we launched it.
Mm.
It was birthed from my experiences, basically. It's one of those things where you never think it will be part of your journey, and then you experience something, and then it happens again and again and again, and you're like, okay, maybe I have to do something about this, because I can't be experiencing, whether it's like horrible or good, you can't be experiencing something over and over again and not do something about it.
Not sure.
So Nyla Foundation is kind of birthed from that. What?
Like, I don't know how to like segue into like the next thing I wanna like say.
Go on.
But damn, I was watching your video.
Okay, the Nyla testimonies.
Yes, mm-hmm. I was watching that, and let me tell you something. After each like pregnancy, I was like, okay, there's good news coming, but it never
and then
came.
It wasn't. Yeah.
I was like, so I was waiting and waiting and waiting.
It's one of those movies where you're watching a movie and you're like, no, it has to end in a happy ending. This is just so sad.
Mm-hmm.
And then in the end, it's like, nope, no happy ending.
Gosh.
Yeah.
That must have been horrible for you.
What, to do the interview or?
No, not the interview. Like,
oh, the journey itself.
The journey itself, you mm-hmm. know, especially like, you know, like no one prepares you for that.
Mm-hmm.
As a person, as a woman.
Yeah.
As a mother to be.
Mm-hmm.
Like life just is like, oh, you think you're dope? Take this.
Yeah.
Then take it again.
Yeah, no, take that's literally how it felt.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, that's literally how it felt. But the funny thing is, loads of people have reached out to me saying I made them cry or sorry and so sad. But then that wasn't the vibe I was trying to put across. I know like maybe I was emotional in the interview because obviously it's an emotional thing to talk about. And I was being vulnerable completely because I needed to share this experience to help others.
But for me,
like, I'm glad it moved people. But the bigger picture was the message at the end, which was we need to raise more awareness about this thing that happens to 1 in 4 women, and we need to be more sensitive towards it, because in Nigeria here, it's just horrible. Like everywhere in the world, really, there's so much pressure to get married, have a baby, and then that's it. But then for me, it's kind of like, okay, so I've tried to do that and it didn't work, but who's to say it won't, or why does it have to happen right now? So for me, it was one of those things where it's like, it's good that people are actually starting the conversation. But the best thing for me was that people, I think over 20 people reached out to me saying, oh, I'm going through it right now too. And that was good because that's what I wanted. I want to help people that are going through it as well. So I guess I was like fulfilling in a way that I actually, I guess, brought out the nerves in some people to, even if it's just in my DMs, they actually came out and say, hey, it's me too, I'm going through this. And that's like pretty special.
How did you feel during like speaking your truth in that moment?
What, in the interview?
Yeah, in the moment.
I don't know, sad, but kind of free, I guess, because it's something, when something happens to you once, right? It's like the worst thing ever, because it's like it's the biggest shock. You don't expect it to ever happen. And when it happens, you're like, oh, shit, like, this is horrible. Am I allowed to swear?
Of course.
Yeah, so the first time, like, it was like, okay, cool. But when it happens a second time and then it happens a third time, you sort of get numb to the feeling, because it's almost like, okay, yeah, for sure it's going to happen a fourth and fifth and sixth time.
Are you kidding?
Yeah, so, like, of course, it's not good to have that kind of mentality, but it's a thing where, okay, I've been through it 3 times now, but I'm strong enough to say, if it happens again, I'll be okay. If it doesn't happen again, amazing. But then now it's beyond how I feel. It's more about who else is feeling this way and how can I help. So I'm in a position, thank God, that I can help. So with the foundation, so I'm hoping it actually does that.
For me, the worst thing about that video was the fact that
like, what?
You know, like, see, I'm a guy, right? And but I'm also like very empathetic. So I was literally putting myself in your shoes. And all I could think of was, wait. This babe got pregnant. She gets pregnant easily. Mm-hmm. And she loses it just as easily.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that is the worst trick.
Mm-hmm. Like, it's almost like a really bad joke.
Yes. Yeah.
No, it's definitely like that. especially when you don't know and it's not you that's gonna like decide the outcome. So you're kind of just like, okay, cool. And then like whatever happens, happens, and you're like, okay. Yeah. No, it's quite deep, honestly.
It's like giving a baby candy and then taking it away.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, fuck's
yeah.
Sake. And
nah, it's deep.
Yeah, and I can imagine like how that made you doubt yourself and you know, your like everything about not like being a woman, being a person, like it almost feels like, would you say this is the toughest thing you've gone through? Of course.
No, yeah, definitely. You know, it's funny because when I went through this the first time, second time, I didn't really look. It's like, I think the third time I went through it, then I started looking online for like people that have been through it too. And I think it was the third time I went through it that Gabrielle Union came out to share her story. Michelle Obama came out to tell her story. And then Beyonce as well came up saying that she had her miscarriage and it was the worst feeling of her life. And I started thinking, oh, wait, like all these people you look up to and you're constantly seeing going through their careers, you never realize they went through all of this. And they're acting as if nothing happened. And you would never know, obviously, because it's a private thing. Mm. And I look back on my life and I'm like, nobody would have ever known either, because I'm there making my films, traveling around Nigeria. Nobody has no idea that like in this 2 year gap, I've been in the hospital for maybe like 6 months of it or something. So yeah, it's pretty deep.
Yeah. So now, like knowing this now, you're like in the best position to like know that like nothing is ever as it seems.
Mm-hmm.
And that you know, you can never like assume that you know everything or you know someone.
Mm-hmm.
And that gives you some kind of like humility and like it calms you down.
Yeah.
You get. So I think, so my question to you is,
mm-hmm.
are you able to see the meaning in your suffering?
The meaning in my suffering?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, the first time around, I just thought, okay, no. But then when it keeps happening again, then you start to think, okay, maybe there's a bigger picture here. Maybe I'm supposed to do something, which is why I think Nyla Foundation came about, because I could have decided to just keep quiet, go down a different road and just like not say anything about it and just be depressed. But then for me, it's more of, I don't know, maybe it's an influence of my mom and my dad, actually, because they're both quite special in a way where they're always thinking about people.
Mm-hmm.
So I think I've been brought up to think that way. So looking at both their journeys, I see it as, okay, I'm going through this journey now, but maybe there's a bigger picture where I'm supposed to help people along the way. And hopefully it does.
Hmm. Look, I wish you could see inside my mind, but I think, like, it's very important. I think, and I think it's very important for you to have found meaning in this, because if not, you just probably get very resentful, and you let it like weigh you down. Like, in fact, there's no difference between you and any of those like killers who go out and, you know, murder hundreds of people, like mass shootings and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. They've gone through stuff that they just could never deal with properly, and they felt like the world's against them.
You need to act out.
And they go and act out. And one of the worst things you can ever like let to sink and settle in your mind is like, the world's against me. Like, you're being unfairly treated by life.
Mm-hmm.
Once that becomes your story, then you will just act out in so many ways. So, you know, and then you talked about the women who, your aunties, who treated you some kind of way for that. What was that like? Like go into details.
The two that I mentioned, and there's actually a lot more that has happened, but the two that...
First of all, kudos for putting them on blast right there on that...
On the video, right? Like, and I hope they know who they are. But this is the thing, like, most people say it's... Even just a few weeks ago, someone said it to me, this one that you're traveling around doing your documentaries, don't you want to sit down and have kids? But the thing is, so many people say it's, they might not want to hurt you and they might just genuinely be curious. But then it's a thing where, like I said in the video, women experience this and they might have, the people that are saying this to you might have experienced it as well. So why aren't they thinking along the lines of that? Like, do they think you get married and then you just don't want kids. Of course, there are women that just don't want kids. But mm-hmm. I think the majority of women do see themselves eventually having kids, right? Mm-hmm. So it's, I don't know, is this insensitivity that Nigeria, I think, allows, especially our culture? Mm-hmm. Because you hear so many things. There's a book. There's a book that talks about this. I read it recently. I can't believe I've forgotten it. This girl that she gets married and then she can't have kids. And then her mother-in-law is basically now rooting for a second wife because she wants grandkids. Mm. And it's that kind of insensitivity that is kind of promoted, because it's not just one mother-in-law that does it sometimes. It's a whole load. Mm. I'm grateful my mother-in-law is like so supportive and she completely understands the whole thing and there's no pressure. But then there's so many other women that are pressured like that deep. And the thing is, our culture allows for it. Mm. There's no one, it's because it's the older people that are doing it. So there's nobody to say, hey, stop that. Because of course there's a respect thing as well.
Yeah.
So you find it's most of the people that are doing the bullying are actually the older women.
Yeah.
And like that needs to change.
It does.
Someone needs to actually get up and say, like, with all due respect, shut up and actually think for a second. Like, you've probably gone through it as well. If she's not having kids, do you think maybe she just doesn't want to, or maybe she's like, something's going on? Mm-hmm. So I think there needs to be like a, I don't know, someone needs to put it on blast, especially to the grown-ups.
You do it.
I should do it, right? I should, honestly. I made a video at the start of the year where it was basically different Nigerians talking to the camera, saying hurtful things. And in the end, it says words cut deep. But I think there needs to be a lot more like awareness and advocacy in terms of getting that message across, like to stop being insensitive.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You guys know me as the host of this amazing podcast. But when I'm not podcasting, I run a creative agency that builds brands and creates experiences for businesses. It's called Avo Creative. As a business owner, you're competing with hundreds of other businesses who offer similar products and services. If you're going to stand out, you're going to need a well-defined brand that connects deeply with your audience. This is where we come in. We are the creative upper class. When it comes to ideas, we're in a different tax bracket. We help our clients build their business brands using a combination of strategy and creativity to astonishing effect. So if you're an entrepreneur, experienced or just starting out, visit our website, avocreativehouse.com. That's avocreativehouse.com. Let's make magic together. Yeah, Nigerians do have it's the thing with our society is that is the pressure to conform.
Mm-hmm.
Conform in thinking the same way, doing the same things as your peers, as everyone else. You know how parents can be like, see what your mates are doing, why don't you, you know?
Of course.
Those kind of things.
Mm-hmm.
So it's on us, people like you and I, who are going to be parents in a couple of years, you know, to become more conscious of the kind of messages and the kinds of techniques we're going to use to like raise our kids, and also get them to do the things that we feel are mm-hmm. right, because we're wiser, we know better.
Yeah, you know, we can change it at some point.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah. You know, so, I mean, I know there are ways you can talk to someone about having kids that would not come off as insensitive.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there are ways to have these conversations without intruding or imposing
mm-hmm.
your will on someone else's life.
Mm-hmm.
And it's one of those things that our parents have found it hard to like understand, like, it's not your life.
Mm-hmm.
Do you get?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you birthed us. Yeah, you clothed us, put us through school, and did all those amazing things that you didn't get while you were, you know, coming up. But
mm-hmm.
you know, at some point, the bird has to leave the nest.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like any young person today who's able to like force that independence, because they won't give it to you. You got to take it. That's what I've learned.
Yeah, you need to be bold.
You need to be bold. You need to be rebellious.
Mm-hmm.
And take it, because if you don't, oh my goodness, you will live a very unhappy life. I see it all the time. People who are just like, my mom is just
mm-hmm.
make me do this, my mom that, like,
Like at what point are you going to stand up and actually take control of your own life?
Take control.
Yeah. You know? Well, the thing is also, a lot more people are reliant, I guess, if that's a word, on their parents, which is why they have such a control on them. I mean, once you get your ass up and be independent and financially independent, emotionally independent, then you begin to realize you can actually make your own decisions. But if you're depending on your parents your whole life, how do you think it's going to like end up? Of course, they're going to have control over you in the end.
Yeah.
So you have to be able to get up and actually do something with your life. Like, well, even if it's like a creative, for instance, you don't have to be a lawyer or an architect or a doctor to be independent. Like, I'm a filmmaker. Like, in the North, I don't know many Northern female filmmakers. But here I am, I'm independent, off of my husband, off of my family. Like, I can carry for myself kind of thing.
Yeah.
So people need to, I guess, be bold enough to take that step.
That's and that's actually the first step towards being a god, because once you're once you're easily swayed by the opinions of others, or you're not like in your own element, you can't like you don't know what you want and go for it. That's like, yo, and you know what I'm talking about. Like, it's just that now I've put a name to it, but
no, I get what you're saying.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's funny because this Nyla Foundation thing, a lot of people tell me they're like, oh, people usually start foundations when they're like in their 50s and they've blown and they have money. Like, you're 25. Like, do you even have that much money to like run a foundation? And I'm just thinking, like, it's not so much about the money. I don't need money to open an Instagram account and constantly tweet about the information that people need to know about maternal health. Like, I don't need money to literally walk into a university or ask them if I could like do a 1 hour talk. It's things like that. Going to a community with like freaking just 20,000 naira worth of diapers and just give people that have just had babies, like, to prevent illnesses or like infections. Like, you don't need to have, like, in this day and age, there's so much access to resources that you don't need it personally. So I think having that whole thing, like having that whole thing of, oh, I can't do this because I don't have money, like, I think it's all crap, to be honest. If you really wanted to get something done, you would. Another thing also is people say, why are you coming out telling your story now when you don't even have a kid? Usually people come out and say their story after the success.
Yeah.
And so for me, a friend of mine, I won't put her on blast. But she said it to me, but not as a hurtful thing. She was just like, aren't you scared of telling your story? Especially how, like, you know, bad belly people and people have evil eyes on you. And to be honest, for me, it's not like, I know I don't have my success story and I don't know if I ever will, like Gabrielle Union going through surrogacy and having her baby then coming out to talk, or Michelle Obama having her kids before coming out to talk. But for me, whether I talk now or talk later, it's still going to impact the people that I need to impact. So why don't I start earlier? Because surely there are other people that haven't had their success stories as well. So me speaking up, they can put themselves in my shoes, if that makes sense. So for me, that's what I'm trying to do, basically.
Before you spoke out, I'm sure you spoke to other people in your circle, you know, about it.
Before I shared my story?
Yeah.
Or
was it like new to most people? Even like, I mean, I'm sure your mom would know and like close family members, but like,
before I did this interview?
Yeah.
I think I just spoke to my husband. Yeah. I literally just told him, look, I wanna do something, so let's do this. And he's like, yeah, sure, I support you if you're ready or emotionally stable to do it. I'm like, yeah. And then I literally just went into the fund, Panduleni. I work with one of my friends. I literally went in and I'm like, okay, we need to do these like Nyla Foundation testimonies. We've actually supposed to be doing it for like, we're supposed to do it like ages ago, but because of work, I haven't been able to. So now I'm like, okay, October is Pregnancy and Infant Loss Awareness Month. I need to do something. So I literally just said, cool, let's just drop it now. But the thing is, it's a testimony thing. So next month we'll have someone. Following month, we'll have someone. Right now, we have about 4 different interviews and we're actually getting more people saying they want to share their story. And trust me, if you think mine is emotional, the one we're releasing next month is deep. She went through 8 miscarriages. 7 miscarriages and 1 stillbirth. No, and 1 baby that died a few days after birth. And but then now she has her two kids. So there's a success story there.
Yeah, but then
the thing is, once you listen to her tell her story, the first, the second, the third, the fourth, the fifth, the sixth, seventh, and you're just thinking, okay, no. This is insane. Like me looking at her, I'm just thinking like, for me to even think I would get to a seventh, I'm like, hell no. Yeah. And she went through it and she has two kids to show for it. So it's kind of like these things like happen.
You know Alhan Islam?
Mm-mm.
The poet.
I think I've heard.
Yeah, you probably should have. She's one of those like Arewa's shining stars. She's a poet. She speaks at a lot of events.
Okay.
And she was at one of my... So I do what is called the Young God Experience,
mm-hmm.
which is where I have these conversations, but live in front of an audience.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, and Alhan Islam, she was a guest for that.
Mm-hmm.
And we're talking, and she was talking about... how she had her first child just after losing her mother.
Mm.
Yeah, so she fell into a deep depression because she always felt like she lost her mom to gain the child.
Mm.
You get, and her mom were really, really close. So she talked about how for days and weeks she couldn't like hold the baby. She didn't want to see the baby.
Mm-hmm.
You know, she stopped writing, stopped doing all the things that made her happy, you know. And then she talked about also her husband, how he was so supportive and he like, you know, didn't hold it against her. And he would like bring the baby. I'm like, don't you want to see him? Don't you want to like do it for me? Don't you love me? You get that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, in my mind, I feel like part of this, you know, part of getting to where you are is, you know, having those men, you know, who are not your stereotypical husbands, who are there and like, know all the right things to do and say in your moment of need.
Mm-hmm.
How do you feel about that?
No, I think definitely for you to go through certain things in life, you have to have a support system, a rock in a way. Mm. So some people are fortunate enough to have that. And luckily I am as well.
Mm.
But some people don't. And it's a lot harder when you have to go through things alone. So when you have that one person there, it's good to always connect and share that because... you can't carry everything on your head, basically.
Yeah, but it's not the norm in the North, right? Like, especially with the way, you know, families are looked at there. You know, men don't usually understand these kind of things. And they kind of, like, leave women to their own devices.
Yeah.
Like figure it out. Like, but you're going to raise this child, whether you like it or not. You get that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I've heard those ones. So, and the fact that Alhan Islam and her husband, they're, like, decades... apart in age.
Okay.
She's like 22, he's like 38.
Okay.
Yeah. They married when she was 19. You get that kind of thing?
Mm.
And, you know, when you think of that kind of age gap, you think of the worst aspect of...
that he would be backwards.
Yeah.
But he
know?
Isn't.
But he is, you know, he was... And I was fortunate to meet him.
Mm-hmm.
And he is definitely like a rare gem. Do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah, and that's good because I actually think there are more and more men stepping up to be real men and not backwards in a sense where the wife is just there for to produce kids and then that's it. Or take care of the house and all of that. There's more of an emotional connection that's happening in this day and age, which is really good.
Yeah, I think especially now that like life is getting harder and more uncertain in terms of what the future holds, you know, being in a country like Nigeria, just like climate change, just so many things are happening all at once. And more than ever now, you need to have like those kind of emotional connections with people because those will keep you sane when shit hits the fan. Yo, imagine like life is hard out there and you come home and life is also hard inside. Oh my goodness. Like,
nah, it doesn't make sense.
It doesn't make sense.
Nah, it's deep though. It's deep, yo.
So now I feel like, do you feel like not having kids, like, yeah, you didn't have kids, but it's giving you also the space to achieve more in your professional career? I mean, yeah, you didn't have it, but now like, the trade-off is that you could now channel all of that energy into like doing more. So you could say that in the past years that you've not had the kid, you've been more productive than ever, gotten more done. Would you agree with that?
Well, for me, film was a passion, mm-hmm. and then it kind of started feeling like a career because I started doing things that I didn't really want to do, but more because I was trying to gain experience and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But then when I started having these losses, I started looking at it as a form of therapy. So it's a thing where after my first loss, I jumped into making Marked, my documentary, and I just decided I was going to travel like to 20 different states in Nigeria. And I just like fully consumed myself in my work, and then that's it. And then the second time around, I was it I'm Not Corrupt? So I guess you could say that I kind of just put everything into my work, and it was a form of therapy for me. So instead of focusing on my losses, it's more like, okay, what can I do? What else can I do? What else is going good for me? If it's the filmmaking, then let me like put all my energy into that. So yeah.
You know what's interesting about what you just said? It's like, I think more women would be able to deal better with these things if they had other things that they could do that didn't have to do with being a mother or being a woman, you know? Like, imagine if you didn't have that outlet.
Yeah.
You would just go...
I'd be fixated on the fact that all I want to do is have a child.
Yeah.
And I actually... So there's a lady that reached out to me, and she said she had a pregnancy loss, and that's all she could think about. And the doctor says she should wait, but all she wants to do is just try again.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just thinking to myself, like, the doctor said, wait. I know you're impatient and you want to make sure that this happens for you.
Mm-hmm.
But then it's a thing where if she had something else she was doing, whether it was even baking or like work, she wouldn't have to be so fixated on the fact that I want to have this baby right now. Mm. She would have actually like maybe taken her mind off it for a bit, waited, and then gone again to have it. But then, like you said, like you need something else to channel your energy so you're not so fixated on like the fact that you've had this loss and you want it again and again and again, and you're just putting so much pressure on yourself. So once you get past that, then I think it's a bit easier.
Mm.
So film has definitely just been... like, yeah, a go-to therapy thing for me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, oh, definitely.
Man. I feel you. You know what? I, it also applies for me. It's like, there's a time when I couldn't get jobs in my photography career.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, it was so difficult in 2015. It was when Buhari just became president.
Mm-hmm.
And then we entered the recession.
Mm-hmm.
So people were not paying for this kind of services.
Mm-hmm.
And I was not the best at promoting myself.
Mm-hmm.
Like before, they would look for me. Now I had to look for them.
Yeah. You needed to
put
more effort into trying to get the gigs.
Yeah. So when I had those, you know, trying times,
mm-hmm.
I was thankful that I had other like outlets. Mm-hmm. I was writing my book. I said, okay, you know, since this is not working, I can focus on my book.
Yeah.
Yeah. Focus on other things. And, you know, so the best thing is just not trying to, like, making the best of any situation you get. I think that's the main thing for anybody who's, you know, trying to live this life.
Yeah, no, definitely.
Like, have as many outlets as possible so that, you know.
So once one thing fails, it's not like it's the end of the world.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. What do you envision as the best version of yourself?
Beyonce.
No, she's already doing her. You gotta do you.
I'm joking. Actually, growing up, I actually thought like, yeah, I was gonna be like Beyonce.
And then when I actually
not sing and dance, but just like the person that she is as a whole. And then when like I actually heard that she had a miscarriage, I was like, yeah, I'm going through the whole thing. Yeah. But I don't know. I guess the best... What was your question again?
The best version of yourself.
The best version of myself would probably be me as I am now, but making a bigger impact. So I think I'm on the right path. I mean, I'm just making decisions as I go along. But like, I hope as I grow, I can make a bigger impact through my films, through my foundation, and just generally doing me.
What about your films? Like, what's your ideal?
My ideal?
Yeah.
I think I want to be internationally recognized as a Nigerian filmmaker, making films that can compete with international films. I want to be able to make a statement on our culture, on our identity, and I guess showcase it for the world to see. Mm. That we from Nigeria can actually be as big and mighty as Hollywood.
Do you have any great stories from any of your trips? Like anything eventful that stuck with you as you... Like, let's say with the Scarred project, you went to 20 states. Surely something eventful happened. Could be related to the project or not, but...
I can think of two things.
Okay.
But they are both very dangerous things. So the... You know Kajuru in Kaduna?
Mm-hmm.
So we went back and forth there like twice.
Kajuru Castle, right?
Kajuru Castle, yeah. But it's a local government called Kajuru as well.
Oh, okay.
So we kept going to film there.
Mm-hmm.
And then the day after we left, it was when that massive like killing happened. So like all those killings happened and we're just like, oh shit. Like imagine if we were there with our crew and everything and this whole thing like started up, like where would we go? So... That was something pretty scary. And then, What else that's memorable? Actually, there are quite a few memorable. They're all like weird things though. So we went to Badagry.
Mm-hmm.
And we went to basically like document why tribal marks happen.
Mm.
And I remember we went to see one of the local chiefs of one of the, in the Badagry township.
Mm.
And I remember thinking like the place was amazing. I think I'm going to buy some, like a plot of land in Badagry. I think it's one of the most beautiful places I've ever seen in Nigeria. Like with the beachfront. Mm. It kind of just had like Barbados vibes. It was like really chill. There was like a guy with dreads playing the guitar, like on the beach. Mm-hmm. Like it was like really cool. But we went to go see one of the chiefs and we asked him why he had tribal marks. And he started telling us about how they worship snakes.
Mm-hmm.
And how he told us about the Adam and Eve story, but that the snake was the one that impregnated Eve.
Are you kidding
me? That is how we came to be. And I remember just looking at this, like I was listening to like, obviously I was like trying to like focus on the camera and the sound. And I just remember like, wait, what? We just went like left real quick. And like, he kept going on. He spoke for like an hour and we had like, there wasn't electricity in some of the places we went. So we had limited batteries.
Oh, shit.
And I was just thinking, like, I want to just, like, cut it off and just say, okay, thank you, and go. Because clearly I'm not going to use this in the documentary.
Yeah.
But it was just so interesting to the point where I just stopped recording and, like, turned my camera off. And I was just listening to this guy. And he had this crazy story about how they worship snakes and how snakes are the real gods and all of this stuff. And I was just thinking, like, this is insane. Like, this is, like, Nigeria in 2017 or 2018 that we went to Badagry.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just thinking, like, this is insane. Like, this guy genuinely believes, like, snakes are, like, the gods and stuff like that. So that was, like, pretty insane. Like, being able to, like, explore other people's beliefs and, like, meet the weirdest, most random people.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Like, yeah, that was pretty mad.
Oh, man.
Yeah. But the views, like, Nigeria has the most amazing views I've ever seen. Like, I don't know if it was the drone, but, like, the views, the beaches, the palm trees, like, the desert land. Like, there's so much, like, we have to offer, but we're just not exploring it. Of course, because of security issues, but... I guess also because we're so fixated on Nigeria is ugly and the rest of the world is so beautiful and we want to go on holiday elsewhere. But I honestly believe places like Yankari and Bauchi, Badagry could be like amazing tourist destinations.
Yeah.
And I'm definitely going to explore that at some point, especially Badagry because I'm in love with that place.
Oh, yeah.
If I could go back now, I swear I want to take my whole family because they've got like the history, they have their museums and like the slave families are still there. So like we met a few people that like their fathers used to be... Their fathers used to be slave owners mm-hmm. and they were black men that owned slaves and would sell them to the whites.
Mm.
And then you'd see like, it's just so much history. And then like, there's so much to see and like,
mm-hmm.
we're just not like utilizing that.
I tell you.
And the beach, like, oh my gosh, like the resorts that you could create on those beaches, they're amazing. And the water is just so calm. It's really cool.
And no one is utilizing that.
Nobody. Like, you go there and it's just so quiet. Like, it's so peaceful. Like, I don't know how to explain Badagry to you. It's one of the best places I've been to.
Maybe it's for the best that it's actually... Because if more and more, like...
Tourists.
People have interest. Not tourists, but, like, interest groups, like, maybe some corporation or whatever just said to, like, fix it on that place. They could mess it up, you know? People...
Yeah.
It's that way because no one pays attention to it. If people start paying attention to it,
it can change them.
It will change in an instant. So,
but then, yeah, I guess so. I guess if it's about how you would do it. So you wouldn't go in and start making like skyscrapers. You would go in and like make results that look like what was already there. Yeah, so you kind of fit in, not try and change it. Because there's some structure. I think they started some like tourist structure. There's a point of no return thing there, and it's like a weird bridge that's supposed to symbolize like leaving onto the ships and never coming back. I think that was just abandoned. It's just like a structure there that's not completed, and I don't know why. But something I definitely want to see, look into.
I feel you. Mm-hmm. Hey. Oh, I have a gift for you, by the way.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Awesome.
So
it's not even my birthday.
Do you like sunglasses?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I've had one particular pair of sunglasses for like 6 years, the Ray-Bans.
Yeah.
And that was actually influenced by Beyonce. Hey.
Beyonce. You know. Beyonce.
I'm a huge fan of Beyonce's. I kind of, it died down a bit when I got older, but then now I think it's coming back slowly.
Yeah, because now you're a woman now. Mm. Like, you know what it means to be a woman, and you're seeing her like she's the embodiment of like womanhood.
Yeah, no, she's quite cool. And she's been through like a hell of a lot.
For sure.
Like things that we don't even know about because obviously like we don't see, like I said, about how people go through stuff and you don't even know.
Yeah.
But the things that she has let us see, I'm sure there's just way more.
Like you don't get to that level without going through stuff. Like there's no way in life you get to be Jay-Z or Beyonce without seeing some shit. In fact, there's a saying that goes a little bit like this. Like, in order for a tree to reach heaven, its roots must first sink to hell. Mm-hmm. You get that? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's deep.
Yeah. So when you think about that in everything that you do, in fact, personally, anything I go through, every rejection, every difficult thing, I always think of it like there has to be a silver lining. Like this has to make me better. Like
it needs to happen to, I guess, elevate you to the next level.
Because if I don't think that way, it's very easy to like just get defeated and feel like...
And that's most people, you know. That's why we don't have as many Beyoncés as there are in the world, as many Jay-Zs. True. Because not everybody can continue going after so much heartbreak.
Not everyone is a god. Hmm. Yeah. There's the gods, there's the mere mortals. Check it. Yeah. But anyway, this podcast is sponsored by Shushi.
Okay, cool.
You know Shushi Shades?
Yeah.
Yeah. And... any guest that comes on, I give them a pair.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, so there's several colors. You get to choose which one you want.
Yeah. Cool. Thank you.
You're very welcome. Very, very welcome. So, okay, then, you can have this.
Thanks. Cool.
Yeah.
No, nice.
No, before you put them away, you gotta put them on. That's.
I have to put them on.
Let's see how it looks.
They're not my style of glasses. Let me show you what I usually wear, and then I'll see if I'm bold enough to change to Shushi Shades.
Okay.
Where are my glasses? So this is me. Like this is the definition of me. So this is like drastically different from who I am.
Yeah.
But yeah, cool. I'll try them on.
Try them on. Let's see. Let's see.
Do they fit my head shape?
Yes, they do.
I hate pictures, you.
Hey, come on now. Don't be shy.
Are you going to use me for free advertising?
All right. So, this has been a great, great 1 hour of just, you know...
Thanks for having me. It was chill.
I mean, it was a good way to kill time. You know,
yeah, no, it's
talking,
good.
Sharing, just understanding. But now I think I have a better feel of you now.
So now you know who I am as an individual.
No, I do not. It's a better feel. No, I don't know. I don't know jack shit. You know, but just a feel. Like I can. If someone says, "What's Nadine like?" I can say a few things.
Say she's chaos.
Chaos. Oh, one more thing. We gotta. Okay, you know what? Let's shout out. Let's close the show first of all.
Okay. Cool.
So Nadine, thank you very much for coming on the Young God podcast, a podcast for gods. This is amazing. Don't look at me like that.
Thanks for having me. It was fun. It was a chill conversation.
Yeah, it was. It was. And please share. And yeah, so let us know like your handles? Where should we follow you? Where can we find you? What are you doing? What do you want people to know about the foundation and your projects?
So the foundation is Nyla Foundation on Instagram.
Yeah.
I think it's Nyla Foundation NG.
Mm-hmm.
And then I've got my Nyla Media page where you can check out like my media stuff. And then there's Nadine Ibrahim Films. And that's basically me.
That's it. Yeah,
I'm the one manning that.
Yeah, that's
that social media handle. But yeah.
Yeah, we knew that because
about it. Check out Marked, the trailer. It's not out yet. Hopefully it'll be out soon. And yeah.
When is it gonna be out? You don't know yet.
Not sure yet. Yeah. We're still submitting to festivals and stuff like that. We're going to AK Festival next week actually, so that's exciting in Lagos.
Okay, maybe we'll drop that around that time too. You know. But yeah, thank you very much for coming on. This is dope. And
thanks.
I feel like I've learned a lot. I hope you have too. And let's just go out there and keep doing
great things.
Yeah.
Inspiring people.
If not us, then who?
Right.
Yo, we've taken on a challenge. Like you could easily coast. You ain't got to do shit. You know what, right? You can just go be a pretty wife and just like enjoy life. Maybe open a little business shop. And like sell wigs or, you know, things that people like, but you've put yourself out there. You know what it means to go to 20 states in Nigeria and document shit? I don't know. Yo.
Challenge yourself.
Do you get?
That's the goal. Keep challenging yourself. Once you get comfortable, then it gets boring. So.
You heard it, people. That's Nadine Ibrahim, the one and only. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you.
Rodney Nadine. Out. If you like this episode, don't forget to subscribe, share, and follow me on IG at The Young God Pod and on Twitter at I Am The Young God. Slide in my DMs anytime, send me a message, comment on my post, and I'll be happy to hear from you. I'll respond, and let's build a community of people who are just doing the most, trying to be better, working on excellence, and are just dope, yo. From one go to another, Rodney out.